The map of the experiment we're dealing with, it's about 5.5 acres, and if you look at the bottom of the page 12, and I'll read it out, there's the sign material for most of this experiment is vernier, and we were kind of conscious it's a bit of a test. We knew just to the north of this, just beyond that windbreak in the north, is the first find of canker, and it's heavily infected with canker. So thinking of resistance, whatever we plant, we thought we'll try vernier, although Valencia would obviously have been, it's known to be more resistant than Hamelin. So, but vernier was what we chose, and it's an interesting new variety, relatively new. And so the rootstocks, of course, were the next choice. We know already from our experience with other trials, the one at Gapway Groves in particular, that even just comparing Swingle rootstock with C35, which we included here, we were getting quite dramatic and remarkable, in fact, advantages. There's an interaction of the rootstock with the type of cultural system that you use, in this case the root ball culturing system with hydroponics. And so we included C35, and then we have X639, and we also thought we'll put something, a really wild card in here. We put rough lemon in, thinking, you know, vigor. You'd think it would not be a good match for a high density, high vigor, but we think we can control the vigor with the root ball cultural system. And thinking of another important test, well, the reason why we included that is the high vigor we thought might offset some of the detrimental effects of the HLB. If there's a benefit of a strong rootstock on this, under the sign, we thought maybe that's what would be worth trying. So it's a test. And then the last on the far left, which is on the west side of this block, southwest side, and it's replicated in the north also, you'll see that we have Valencia cuttings. We actually intended to use vernier and we couldn't get them in time, so we settled for Valencia cuttings. So that's not on a rootstock. So that's the treatments with the actual trees, what we're comparing. And these were planted, they're only just over a year, well, they are just on a year old. It was March of 2011, so you can see the growth so far. The cuttings were a little later. All the detail is in this handout. The cuttings were only, they're probably only 6 months in the ground. And you can see that they're much behind in growth. So looking at the top of page 12, the color coding, color-coded sections there, you'll see, and the spacing, it's 8 by 18 feet spacing, which gives you 303 trees per acre. So it's much higher than a standard modern spacing. We found that to be quite a good sweet spot, actually, because it does allow relative easy access to conventional farm equipment, the 7.5 or 8 foot wide tractor, and it would be no problem at all for a 48 inch wide tractor, which are now very very much available too. And of course the large goat trucks, there's no small versions of those around yet, wouldn't have much of a problem with an 18 foot spacing. And we also we firmly understand we can control the tree size here with the system of irrigation and fertigation, especially with the drip system producing that root ball, which most of you have heard us talking about in the past. So it's powered all by, or irrigated by, a 4-inch well, which you see by the green shed. There's some photographs also on the handout, I'll go to those in a second, showing you the operating principles and the components. Freeze protection is with the main pump down the road where we started. So that's the raised jets you'll see on the trees. And it was absolutely a lifesaver here. Had we not had those this past winter, there was ice on these trees. They would have probably died, we think. So it's a cold spot here. And it's not the only one in Florida. So be careful with young trees and make sure they have freeze protection with water. So looking at one more time at that map on page 12 at the top, the green circles are all drip fertigation. So we want to encourage that root ball development, and that's the way we want to supply the nutrients and the water to those trees. And then moving on to the blue circles, those are all microsprinkler irrigated, but they have controlled release, slow release fertilizer. So that's the next comparison, and it's replicated to the north and the south. And then the last ones, like the pink colored circles, are microsprinkler fertigation. So we have three different methods of delivering water and nutrients here. I think that's enough on that page. So I thought an important part, seeing as this is clearly work in progress, there's no results, there's no differences to show yet, which you can understand after 1 year. But the map is there. If you have any time, just walk around and have a look at the different treatments. But to me, it's all the same at this stage. So I'd rather spend a bit more time on I think an important question is how to set this up. So if you go to page 13, I often get questions over the phone and elsewhere. And I'll just quickly go through those. I think I've labeled everything on there. So it's easy, really easy to see. And you can have a look. The door's open there. You can look inside that room and see what we've done. But starting from the first figure there, we have a broadband antenna, which is for the control of it. And if you have time, I can turn it on from here. I can control everything from my iPhone in my pocket here. Anywhere in the world where I am, I can control it. I can program it. I can monitor it. I get error messages. So it's full control. And we relay that from the main mast up there. And then we've got Comcast broadband internet service there. So we were able to get from the street. So there's many ways of doing it, but that final hop can be done for many miles wirelessly like that. So we have, this is a repeater here. Then that goes through a serial server, which you'll see on the bottom figure, where it's connected in the room. And that then translates the broadband internet to a serial port. So it's essentially like a long serial cable all the way from here to Lake Alfred or wherever we are. And that then connects to the controller, and we use a NetFM NMC Junior, which you see a picture of also on the bottom of the page inside the room. And start going back to the top. Let's work from the weld. It's a 4-inch weld, like I said, submersible pump. We run it through a 40 psi pressure regulator, so that there's no, especially because for an experiment, we don't want different pressures for different zones. If you had a block like this with all the same, you didn't have zones, I would skip that pressure regulator. You don't need it. So it's for experimental purposes. And then we have double check valves, the usual to prevent backflow, followed by a good screen filter with automatic flush valve that the controller can actually backflush that automatically or wash it out. And then of course a good quality water meter, and we chose the NetFM water meter for that, so that it can record exactly how much water is put on and for how long. And then going into the bottom figure, there's the access point, the Wi-Fi access point shown on the top, the NetFM, the serial server which I talked about, and importantly down to the bottom right is that little red box. It's a motorized ball valve, and you really need a good quality. If you want to automate your system, we've learned from trial and error, you have to just spend a bit of money on it. That costs probably $200 to $300 each. We tried various solenoid valves, and we get corrosion problems. They stick. They're not as powerful as these. You need a good geared motorized ball valve. It's worth getting, and this should last a long time. And it's so important because if you get a leak, if you spring a leak in a 1,000-gallon tank, for example, or fertilizer, it's a problem. So in fact, that main pump down there, we double valve. We've got two motorized valves on it. So if one fails, the other one should hopefully save it. And also periodic replacement would be advised. If you have a lot of fertilizer in stock that could be an environmental hazard, just maintain your valves, maintain everything, start replacing them after a few years. And then the bottom of the figure, there's a NetFM fertilizer flow meter, of course, to meter the amount of fertilizer delivered all through the computer. The computer regulates that. And last of all, there's the electric fertilizer injection pump. And for this 5.5 acre block, we were able to use just a easily obtainable diaphragm pump, as you can see there. And you can look inside the room, like I said. You're welcome to look for yourself. And I think hopefully we have some questions. And I think that's how I'll end off this discussion. Let's open up for question time. Anybody? Have I answered everything adequately already? Or would you like some time? I think it's a good time to just if we have time at all, just 2 or 3 minutes walk around. There's a question there.
How often is it a problem that you lose your Wi-Fi signal and somebody has to, has that happened or?
Not with Wi-Fi, no. So the question is, how often do we have intermittent interruptions of service? After a storm, we've had some outages of electricity as well as Wi-Fi. Broadband connection, but the Wi-Fi system itself, unless there's a direct strike, it's very stable. You could look now. You should be able to get Wi-Fi right here on your cell phone or computer, and it's not encrypted right now, so you're welcome to use it if you want. Yeah, but it's strong. Yeah, and we've got at the Gapway site, we've converted to Wi-Fi now too, and we have a two mile hop there repeater. It can go up to 10 or 20 miles if necessary with the right equipment. So, and this is just cheap equipment. That Wi-Fi repeater there costs just $50. It's because it's mass produced, it's really cost effective. All right, just wander around, folks, for a little bit, and then we'll walk back to where we were, and Tim Spann will continue.
Without all the bells and whistles that you need for research, what would the basic unit cost for installation on site?
I'll look for some help from Troy Gainey, but yes, a lot cheaper, maybe. I'll have to just start with the components, I think. $2,500 for the controller, you'll need that. The well, most people here would probably have a better feel for that, but it could be $10,000.
You have to have a well to irrigate.
Yeah.
Above regular irrigation.
All right.
What would you be?
Storage tanks are expensive. That one probably costs $200-$300. A big one will cost you close to maybe $1,000. They're quite expensive, even the plastic tanks. Flow meters are $200-$300 for the big ones. Filters $100. You know, you're talking about under $10,000. I think easily, yeah, for 5.5 acres like this. Now then, remember you have to basically put two sets of water delivery in, one for freeze protection and one for, if you want to do drip irrigation, that is. If you're going to do micro sprinkler fertigation, you've got it already. So that's the attraction of using micro sprinklers, is that of course it's dual purpose. You can do freeze protection and feed the plants with it.
And you've collaborated with Ron over there, and you've already estimated the time it would take to recover your capitalization cost on that.
Very much so. Ron has developed a really good model for it. It's on a spreadsheet at this stage, and I've seen it, and he presented some of those data. I presented on his behalf, and he may have in other talks, but at the Florida Citrus Show, I showed some slides of that, and it looks very promising. The problem is we have encroachment of HLB on all of these plantings, every young planting that we know of, including all our hydroponics plantings, the one at Immokalee, the one at Gapway. This one doesn't yet, incidentally. As of October, this had none, but it's only a year old, so it'll come. And so that drastically alters your modeling and your projections. But Ron is the man to discuss that with. Yeah, he's got some good numbers. And sorry, he's here. He's standing right beside me here. Yeah. Can you raise your hand, Ron? In case there's any economics questions, he's the expert. Okay,